Hey guys, Alex from 7th Hour Films back again with Full Metal Alchemist Brotherhood. Last time around, we had The Shape of This Country, where basically they threw Sloth out into the cold and froze him, and then they went into the tunnel and they were away from prying eyes, so Ed and Al told Olivier the whole story. And they realized that the last place in this transmutation circle they were making in the country was at Briggs, so they need to prepare for that. That's when Lieutenant General Raven showed up, and they were like, hey, maybe Olivier can like get in on it and be like a spy. And sure enough, he made the offer of immortality to her. So, yeah, that's pretty much where we left it. As you can see today, it is not burning in here. I don't have the fan next to me. The curtains are open. It is a nice, comfortable 72 degrees as opposed to 79, which it was last week. So we're all nice. We are all comfortable. However, I'm tired. I am tired because it's the afternoon now. I've already recorded 2 episodes. So that's just how it's going to be. So slightly low energy, but hey, we're at least a lot happier than we were last week. So, like always, the reaction is down in the description and in the pinned comment for your viewing pleasure. So let's go ahead and jump right into this episode of Full Metal Alchemist Brotherhood. Here we go. Okay, interesting stuff. You know, for the longest time I've talked about, you know, how Fuhrer, he can be so annoying when he's just like, well, we are the best and blah 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 and weak stupid people and stuff. And hearing that echoed by General Raven was so rough. So it is so satisfying to watch him die. I mean, that is a straight up, and I love that. I love that too. She straight up murdered him. Not only murdered him, but kind of, because she stabbed through the arm, then she slashed across his chest. He would have died anyway from blood loss, but then pushed him into the cement for him to, you know, be consumed as he died. I love that so much. And I love that. I mean, you know, it's something Roy would do. It's something Risa would do. We all, there's a number of characters who would do that. But I love it because there's so many moments, and even this slightly applies to Ed and Al too, where the hero has to be above killing. And oh my god, sometimes I just like watching a hero fucking murder somebody. You know? And I don't know what that says about me. I don't know what that says about society. And we live there. But, oh my god. Watching her murder him is so amazing, you know? And, you know, we've had, you know, Roy killing Lust. But that's, I feel like that's a bit different because she, you know, was a homunculus. She's a, you know, quote-unquote monster, you know? Killing one of them, maybe that's a bit different. I don't know, but I don't know. But watching her just completely murder Lieutenant General Raven. Oh, that was so good. That was so satisfying, you know? So sad. And again, because they talk about like, oh, well, it's survival of the fittest and stuff. Like, you are an old man. What the fuck are you talking about? Survival of the fittest. Survival of the bullshit. Survival of the people who jerk off father all the time, you know? Jeez. Like, okay, if Kimblee said that, I would at least be like, okay, well, Kimblee can hold himself in a fight, you know? Kimblee's young, he's light on his feet, you know? Granted, saying that, he got his ass kicked by Scar in, like, 5 seconds, but still. Honestly, yeah, it's like, if you want, like, maybe one of the most dangerous fighters in all of Full Metal, I feel like Scar has to rank towards the top. Because, again, one of, you know, this guy who used... this guy who used a Philosopher's Stone to kill so many Ishvalan was, like, bodied in 10 seconds by Scar, who's not an alchemist at all, you know? He's not an alchemist. He just, you know, he understands the destruction power, the deconstruction power, but that's it. That's it. And you almost have to think that that's almost the easier part, you know? Because you just, it's literally just splitting apart atoms, you know? Splitting apart something at a on a molecular foundation, you know? Reassembling it, I would imagine, would be the more difficult part. Getting it either exactly the way you want it or exactly the way it should be. I mean, either way, I feel like that has to be the harder part. But if you just understand what's there and how to split it, that's one thing, you know? But still, survival of the fittest. You were just some old fucking man, you know? Like the Fuhrer. Even the Fuhrer, even if the Fuhrer wasn't a homunculus, I would say he's more fit than General Raven, you know? General Raven's just an old man, you know? I gotta listen back to a bit of that.
You're going to lose the one your moldy ass has clung to for too long. Right about now, Raven! You old traitor!
I love all the people. All the soldiers and the workers are behind her. Man, the North friggin' rocks, you know? And I love, too, there is not an alchemist at the North, you know? We go everywhere, and there is at least, like, one alchemist that we find. There is no alchemist here at all. And they are a force to be reckoned with, you know? And that's the thing, you know, I'm thinking, like, well, okay, if it comes down to it, then Ed and Al will have to take on Kimblee, you know? But, of course, they have a new problem of Winry being there, but still. Which, how long has it been since we last saw Winry? Like, when she was actually in the episode. I don't know. It's been a good while. But she's back. Winry's back. Dang it. If only we could have been like, yo, don't... But I mean, what could... Even if she knew, what could she do, you know? If she refused, then she wouldn't have... You know, there probably would have been problems. They would have just taken her by force or... killed Pinako. I don't know. So there was no... wasn't really an option there, but yeah. But Winry's here. And now, you know, they talk about, like, oh, well, you know, Ed needs his automail fixed for, you know, adjusted for the cold. He's been here for, like, 2 weeks, and, like, aside from at the beginning, he's been all right, you know? I don't know. I guess it just hurts. I guess he's just probably, it just aches a lot at the connection, but... I don't know. But yeah, Kimblee brought Winry, so that's a problem. But yeah, it's so nice. And I love, too, that Ed foresaw, you know, that they would close the tunnel and everything. So he made, the two of them made another route in, another entrance into the tunnel, which was good. What was that thing? Like... At first, I was like, is this envy or something? Like, I have no idea. Like, this is something new. Ooh, wait a minute. Is it Pride? We haven't met Pride. We've only heard Pride. Oh, what if Pride, like, doesn't have a physical form or something? Because we had that scene where Pride was talking to Wrath. It's the only time we've ever heard Pride. And it seemed, you know, we never saw Pride. He was just like, I don't know. He was just a voice. So what if it's that Pride maybe does not have a physical form, you know? Which could be, and I suppose that's entirely possible, you know, considering, you know, like, they all have physical forms, but then you have, you know, Envy, who can change their form at a moment's notice, and Gluttony, who, while he had a physical form, he also had the false portal inside of him, you know? So, there's definitely shenanigans that can happen with the homunculi, so it's entirely possible that Pride just doesn't have, at least not a, I don't know, like a sturdy, like a humanoid form, I guess. Pride just could have some sort of strange, ethereal form. I don't know. So that's a problem. Also, the beginning of this episode, where we had a bit of Hohenheim, which was cool. So that was really interesting, just him talking about, like, oh, you know, I'm a monster and stuff like that. And I like, though, that, you know, again, we're getting, like, little snippets of who he is. We still don't fully understand Hohenheim and Father. It could have just been that they were brothers, you know? It could have just been that they were brothers. Honestly, I guess just in a similar manner to how we have Ed and Al, you know? They're not twins. You know, Father and Hohenheim, they definitely look like identical twins, and Ed and Al aren't, but they could just be brothers, you know? They could just be brothers, you know? And while Hohenheim, you know, if one of them, if Father was the one who, you know, wanted immortality and wants all these great things, and maybe he gave this power to his brother, it's turning into My Hero Academia all of a sudden. But maybe he gave this power to his brother, but now his brother's like, you know, basically, you know, he fell in love, he had a family, and at that point he was like, I don't want this anymore. I don't want to be immortal. I want to grow old and die with my family, you know? And now perhaps, you know, that's why he was gone. He was looking for the cure for immortality, which is interesting. So where everyone else is looking for immortality, he's looking to get rid of it, which is interesting. And I love, you know, first off, that the family portrait was really good. And, you know, it's like, oh, well, even when, you know, we're all old, you know, we'll have this picture to remember, and, you know, this is our family, and we'll always remember that. But yeah, but he didn't smile. He was crying. And even then, and it's interesting to see how much Trisha knew about him, you know? She obviously knew that he was immortal, had this immortal body. And we did hear a while back, you know, that there was some sort of promise that she couldn't keep, you know? And she ended up dying, so I'll be very curious about that. To get more on that, but yeah, it's so interesting. I really like whenever we have Hohenheim scenes, you know, and I like that last moment where it's like, you know, he wanted to just leave quietly because he couldn't bear to look at his boys, you know, but he did, and he tried basically containing that as much as he could. And, you know, Ed and Al look at that and think, oh, there's that bastard who left us, and it's like, well, I don't think he's the bastard. I don't think he's the bastard, you know? Interesting shit. Where the hell is he going, though? Like, why is he walking across the country or something? Like, take a goddamn train. I don't know. I don't know. We keep cutting back to him, and he's, like, in the same friggin' place. Like, come on, man! But that's just because I want more of him. I want more of his backstory and Father, and I just want more of that, you know? Other stuff this episode, we had Scar making his way to May and Dr. Marco, and so he should be able to translate the ancient Ishvalan in his brother's notes, because he used to be a monk, which is pretty cool. So hopefully with the three of them combined, they should be able to translate the notes and figure everything out. I like, but I also feel bad for those two soldiers. That is like, it's not just that he knocked them out, it's that he took their coats. I love that he took that they took their coats, you know? Because yeah, they're just going to be left to freeze to death. I mean, hopefully, you know, maybe in half an hour or so they'll get up or something, but yeah, hope they don't have any frostbite from that. And then we got Roy learning things about Kimblee, that Kimblee was injured, but once he was met by General Raven, then he got healed, and Roy now has a message from Olivier, which is pretty cool. So hopefully Fireboy can go north, you know? Hopefully Fireboy can go north and heat things up a bit, you know? But yeah. But really, really great episode. Really enjoyed this. And again, such a satisfying death for Lieutenant General Raven. And I just like that. Let me know. I guess, I don't know, where you guys stand or something. Like, I like it. You know, sometimes. It doesn't have to be all the time. I'm not advocating for every, like, protagonist to be the Punisher or something. But sometimes, you know, when a character is like, oh no, we can't kill. We had that problem recently on The Flash, definitely, when it came to Thawne. But it's like, just kill him. Just kill him, you know? And now, it took a while. She didn't do it immediately, but she did just fucking murder him, and it was awesome. Anywho, but that is basically it. With all that being said, I'm Alex from 7th Hour Films, and I will see you guys next time. Take care. Alright guys, thanks for watching this video. There's a bunch of links on screen if you want to go click around to any of those. There's a playlist for all of my Full Metal Alchemist Brotherhood reactions, as well as another video you can go click on if you want. There's also a subscribe button and a Patreon button on screen, as well as other links in the description if you want to go check out any of those. See you guys later.